Good morning. We would come in, take our seats. We'll get started here. I'm Dr. Thomas E. Gamble, president of Brevard Community College. It is indeed my pleasure to welcome you to another in the series of entrepreneurial development lectures at BCC. These lectures feature well-known figures in the world of business who have distinguished themselves as visionaries and creative thinkers, as well as being solid business leaders. We ask that the audience remain seated until the lecture is over and the question and answer session is concluded. Also, at the conclusion of this session, Mr. Amos's muffins will be distributed. If you would like to order any of Mr. Amos's books, an information table has been set up outside the hall. Now it is my distinct pleasure to introduce the chairman of the lecture series committee, BCC's Dr. Pat Fuller, professor of business.
Well, good morning, students, faculty, staff, all of you. You're in for a big treat this morning. You know, putting together a lecture series like this takes a lot of collective efforts of many people. And I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge the staff of Community Relations, Marketing, and the Lecture Committee for pulling all this together today. I'd also like to thank the faculty of BCC and the area schools for taking time to introduce your students to the spirit of entrepreneurship. I'd also like to acknowledge the Florida Today newspaper for their photography and for their efforts in publicizing this event. Students, be sure that you pick up an attendance card when you leave here today to take back to your instructors to tell them you were here. That's important, along with your muffin. This unique and special lecture series would not be possible without its namesake, Mr. Bernie Simpkins. As you can read the program brochure, this series brings to Brevard County nationally known visionaries who built a business on a hope, dream, and some really hard work. An entrepreneur in his own right who has made an indelible mark on Brevard County, it is my pleasure to introduce to you Mr. Bernie Simpkins today and ask him to come forward to welcome Mr. Amos.
Good morning. Let me first thank Dr. Gamble, Dr. Fuller, Ingrid Nada, the representative of the college, and all of those committee members and the instructors and all of you for being here today. It's a great occasion. The place is full. I want to mention a few things that my good friend I have made acquaintance with today, Mr. Wally Amos, some things about him. He flew yesterday for 15 hours from his home in Hawaii to be with us today. And that's worthy of a big. Mr. Amos was born in the state of Florida, in Tallahassee, and lived there until he was about 12 years of age. He went to New York for a few years, Hollywood for a few years, and it was in Hollywood, when he was 39 years of age, that he developed the famous Amos cookies. And that was the beginning of chocolate chip cookie phenomena that swept the country. You have a copy today in today's program which highlights Mr. Wally's famous rise to fame. In 1975, Wally Amos' famous cookies started the modern chocolate chip cookie industry. His latest business enterprise, Uncle Wally's, has been acclaimed for its tasty, high-quality muffins. And as I mentioned, you can get one when you leave. Wally is also the author of several books like The Cookie Never Crumbles, The Power in You, Man with No Name, Watermelon Magic, and Faith. Not only is Wally Amos a man with a vision, he is a man of faith and a man who has used his fame to support educational causes. Today he's going to give us his recipe for entrepreneurial success. I failed to mention that we're especially pleased to have Dr. Maxwell King with us today, the former president of the college. Thank you, Max, for coming. So without further ado, I give you Mr. Wally Amos.
Give him a little marching music. Bernie, thank you very much for that wonderful introduction. It's too weak. I will put the hat over here then. I always ask for a lavalier mic. The reason I ask for that is to make sure that I have some place to hang my hat, because there's always extra mics, and I just throw my hat on one of them. Well, aloha. That was fair. I bet you can do better than that, though. I know you can. Aloha!
Aloha!
Outstanding. Well, it's great to be here. Always nice to come back home. I was just in Orlando, actually, October 17th. I had a talk over a Disney hotel, and here I am back again. As Bernie said, I was born in Tallahassee a very long time ago, and left at an early age, 12 years old, to move to New York City, which was a very fortuitous move, actually, because it was that move that sent me to New York City to live with Aunt Della. Aunt Della was my mother's sister, and it was Aunt Della that first made chocolate chip cookies for me. And if it wasn't for that move, I wouldn't be back in Florida today, because it was that experience, sitting in that little small kitchen with Aunt Della, where she would make the most delicious and tastiest chocolate chip cookies anyone could possibly have. I shared with Bernie as we were driving in this morning, that one experience has been one of my greatest lessons, actually. And that lesson is that you never know where your life is going. You can never judge any experience in isolation, and every experience has the potential to lead to something really fantastic. And I think the thing you have to do is be open and receptive to it and not judge it, not have it be the way you think it should be, but accepting it as it is and seeing where it takes you and preparing yourself to deal with whatever that experience might offer you in the future. So I'm going to share this morning a few attributes that I think are important. You know, we hear the word entrepreneur, and Bernie and I talked about that this morning, too, that everybody says, I want to be an entrepreneur. And it's just a word, actually. Entrepreneur is simply a word. There's not necessarily a guarantee for success if you become an entrepreneur. There's a lot that goes into being an entrepreneur. And so often people don't give any thought to what that is. You know, I've met so many people say, I want to be in business for myself. You know, I can be my own boss. Let me tell you, when you're in business for yourself, everybody's your boss. I mean, you work for everybody else. And what you don't realize also is that there might be some months or some weeks when you do not get a paycheck. Because when you own the business, you have to make sure your employees get paid first. You have to make sure your vendors get paid. All the bills have to be paid. And if you are fortunate enough to have something left over, then that comes to you. But there are a lot of responsibilities involved in being an entrepreneur. More important, I think, is to be a nice person. It's to be a good person. So I'm going to share some attitudes and some attributes that I think are really critical to be whatever it is that you choose to be in life, whether you're an entrepreneur, whether you're working for yourself, or whether you're working for somebody else. It's important first to be a good person. One of the things, and maybe this is the foundation. I don't know. All of these are important, and they're not necessarily in any order. But I'm reminded of this because I was talking to Brittany earlier, who is Bernie's granddaughter, and we were talking about attitude. I don't care what it is that you're going to be. If you have a great attitude, then you are absolutely destined for success. I would rather have someone working with me that had a strong, positive, loving attitude and minimal skills than someone with all the skills in the world and a horrible attitude. Because that person with a horrible attitude will be a cancer in the workplace, and I, for one, will not want to come to work because I just don't like being around people with nasty attitudes. It brings me down, creates a gloom over the place, creates disharmony in the workplace. You don't want to have that type of person, because what you want to have is a harmonious environment, you know, where everybody's getting along, where everybody's supporting one another. And people with negative attitudes don't create that. So I've got a series of I've got a series of children's books that I share with my audience. I share children's books because I've started a new business. It's called Chip and Cookie. Chip and Cookie are two little chocolate chip cookie dolls that I've trained them to sit up, but they're not responding. Oh my God, my whole thing is falling apart. My hat falls off. My head falls off. The dolls won't sit up. What is this coming to? Ah, there we go. They just needed something to lean on, you know. That's Chip, and this is Cookie. My wife, Christine, created these little characters, and we have developed a business around them. I am back in the cookie business again. I've opened another cookie store 30 years after founding Famous Amos in 75. I've opened another cookie store, this time in Hawaii. There's a phrase that says, grow where you're planted. And when I started Famous Amos, I was planted. I was living in Hollywood, California. That's where I opened the store. I couldn't open it in New York because I was living in California. This time, I am living in Hawaii, and I've opened a store 10 minutes from my home in Hawaii. And we've been open since August 31st, and we're off to a good start. Those that wish to have more information on Chip and Cookie can visit chipandcookie.com. That's chipandcookie.com. Those that want more information on me personally can go to wallyamos.com. I made it really easy for you guys to find the websites, you see. And you can get more information, a nice little picture of the store. And should you come to Hawaii, I expect you to stop by and say hello, and I guarantee you free cookies. So, attitude. I have a Chip and Cookie book also, but I'm using these characters to promote reading aloud. I believe that your business should be for more than just making money. And when I started Famous Amos, I used Famous Amos to promote adult literacy. So for 26 years now, I have been promoting adult literacy, helping adults learn how to read. Because my fame is just a vehicle. It's a vehicle to do greater good, a vehicle to share with the community at large. If you're only doing it for yourself, if you're only doing it for materialism, then you'll never have real success. You might make a lot of money, but in the long run, you will discover that that is not real success and that will not bring you lasting happiness or joy. It's very short-lived. So we're using these little characters to promote reading aloud. Reading aloud, I believe, is absolutely critical to early childhood development. You know, reading is a child's first subject. Parent is a child's first subject. And in a very, very definite sense, reading aloud is early childhood development. If you read to your child from the beginning, as soon as they're born, you will develop a child that is a reader that loves reading, and reading is the foundation of a meaningful life. If you can't read, Everything else really falls on the wayside. So this is going to be my major effort, I think, and it will far succeed what I've done with Famous Amos in promoting adult literacy, because I think this is so important, and I'm so committed and so dedicated to using this business to really make a difference in the lives of future generations. Because in a real sense, that's the only way we're going to get rid of adult literacy, is to begin creating generations of children who love to read, who can read, who look forward to reading. So let's talk about attitude. I've got a little book here. It's called Kenny Rogers Presents the Greatest. It was actually a song that Kenny Rogers sang. The song was written by Don Schlitz. I love children's books for several reasons. One is they're written at a grade level that I can understand. And you don't have to read, like, 300 pages. Look at that. I mean, those small, thin books. Very, 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 very big and width and whatnot. But very small book. You don't have to read, hold it forever. You can just get through it right away. They got big print also, which is definitely need big print. And they got a lot of pretty pictures. So that's a very entertaining package that can hold my attention. Kenny Rogers presents the greatest. A little boy in a baseball hat. He stands in the field with his ball and bat. He says, "I am the greatest player of them all." He puts his bat on his shoulder and he tosses up his ball. And the ball goes up and the ball comes down. He swings his bat all the way around. The world is so still, you hear the sound. The baseball falls to the ground. He says, "I'm the greatest there's ever been." He grits his teeth and he tries again. And the ball goes up and the ball comes down. He swings his bat all the way around. The world is so still, you can hear the sound. The baseball falls to the ground. He makes no excuses. He shows no fear. He just closes his eyes and listens to the cheer. The little boy, he adjusts his hat. He picks up his ball. He stares at his bat. He says, "I am the greatest when the game is on the line." And he gives his all one last time. And the ball goes up like the moon so bright. He swings his bat with all his might. The world is as still can be. The baseball falls. And that's strike three. Now, it's supper time. And his mama calls. The little boy starts home with his bat and ball. He says, "I am the greatest." That is understood. But even I didn't know I could pitch that. Little boys do that, all the time. I did it when I was a little boy. I did it because no one would let me play with him, so I had to play ball by myself. But that little boy, every time I read the story, he's done that many, many times, but I'm so convinced that on that particular day, his attitude was stronger than ever. You see, when your attitude is really positive, and it helps you focus, it helps you see things clearer. gives you laser beam focus. Make better decisions. You make better choices when you have a good attitude. And on that particular day, that little boy, his attitude was the best he'd ever been. It had ever been. And he saw very clearly that the pitcher was having a much better day than the batter, so he chose to be a pitcher. Guys, attitude is everything. Attitude definitely is the way to success. Whatever you do, develop a strong attitude in doing it. Another thing that I've learned that has really been so instrumental in whatever success I've had, and I didn't always understand this lesson clearly. Matter of fact, I knew it very clearly when I was putting Famous Amos together. But then, after Famous Amos was off and running, and everybody was telling me how great I was, and I was Famous Amos, I lost my perspective. It's important to be a part of something bigger than you. It's important to be a part of the team. You're only one member of the team. You cannot ever do everything. The only way you will ever really be successful at whatever it is that you're doing is to have people around you who can do all the other things. And many times, they're going to be able to do them a lot better than you. Surround yourself with people who are smarter than you. That way, you get to learn something. Teamwork is a very, very important ingredient in success. I learned it the hard way. Because I didn't realize that, you know, it was the team and not Wally that was making things happen. I wound up losing Famous Amos. Lost Famous Amos because I got ahead of the team. I thought that being famous was more important than everything else, and that I was the team. And very quickly I learned that there were a lot of people that was involved in the success of Famous Amos. Now, I learned that lesson so well that in starting Uncle Wally's Muffin, I found a young man who became president of the company. And he put a great team together. I leave him alone. The office is in Long Island. I don't spend a lot of time in Long Island because all I can do is confuse him. And I want the company to be successful. So Uncle Wally's is a success, in my mind's eye, greater than Famous Amos, even though we don't have the recognition yet. But in time, we will, and we will have the great sales also. Sales are pretty decent now. This company, a few years ago, we went through bankruptcy. The great thing about that is that we grew the business while we were in bankruptcy. We came out of bankruptcy unassisted. About two and a half years out of bankruptcy, we were able to build a 43,000 square foot bakery that is our own bakery for $6 million without giving up any equity to do that. Now, usually when you come out of bankruptcy, no financial institution wants to touch you. But we had a great CFO, we got a great team, and they put a deal together so that we raised $6 million without giving up any ownership in the company. That's phenomenal. That happened not because of Wally Amos, not because of Lou Avignon, the president, not because of Michael Petrucelli, the chief financial officer. That happened because of everybody, because we are a great team. And once again, starting Chip and Cookie, I've got another great team. I've got a guy who's president of that company. He was president, he was general manager of a Costco in Hawaii. So he really knows day-to-day operations. He knows the business. I leave him alone. I mean, I'm here talking to y'all. He's in Hawaii running the business. So it's a team. I can't stress this important enough. Imagine if you have a great attitude and a great team, that is a wonderful formula for success. You want to be a part of something bigger than you. The conductor of an orchestra, you know, oftentimes all the attention goes to the conductor. But if I were the conductor and you guys were the orchestra, and you weren't prepared, if you didn't have the instruments, you didn't want to play, I don't care how much I wave my arms, ain't no music going to come from you. So you need, it's all about teamwork. It's all about everybody giving their all every single day, everybody being committed to a common goal every single day. Now, this is a book that touches on that subject and several others. It's called The Crayon Box That Talks, written by Shane DeRoe. while walking in a toy store the day before today, I overheard a crayon box with many things to say. "I don't like red," said yellow. And green said, "Well, nor do I. And no one here likes orange. But no one knows just why. We are a box of crayons that doesn't get along," said blue to all the others. "Something here is wrong. Well, I bought that box of crayons and took it home with me and laid out all the colors so the crayons could all see. They watched me as I colored with red and blue and green and black and white and orange and every color in between. They watched as green became the grass and blue became the sky. The yellow sun was shining bright on white clouds drifting by. Colors changing as they touched, becoming something new. They watched me as I colored. They watched till I was through. And when I finally finished, I began to walk away. Oh, and as I did, the crayon box had something more to say. I do like red," said yellow. And green said, well, so do I. And blue, you were terrific, so high up in the sky. We are a box of crayons. Each one of us unique. But when we get together, the picture is then complete. I am more than I am, but less than we are. The only thing you will ever be able to do totally by yourself in life is to fail. You can do that all by yourself. You don't need any help to become an alcoholic. You don't need any help to become a drug addict. You don't need any help to do all the negative things in life. Those are the self-made people. But you show me anyone that has any level of success, and I'll show you a string of people behind him or her that helped them to be successful. So you always want to be a part of the team. You want to be a part of something far greater than you could ever hope to be by yourself. Oh, God, I'm just, you know, I've got so much I want to talk about and so little time to do it in. What time do we have to leave again? We have to leave at 10:30?
We have to leave here at 10:30.
Oh, well, oh, great, it's just 10 o'clock now, so. We're in great shape.
We have some time for questions.
It can change the world in 30 minutes or less. Okay, but because this is, you know, I love this book. It's a little small book. Tiny, tiny, tiny book. But books have big ideas. Books change the course of history. Books change your lives. Reading takes you everywhere. Anything you will ever need in life is in a book somewhere. Or it's being written now. The internet's got everything. You can't even get to the internet unless you can read. Reading's critical in life. This book was written by Shel Silverstein. He was a great guy. He was a fun guy also. He wrote fun books, but his books are very inspirational and very, very, very insightful. God bless you. This book was written in 1964. Books never die. Can't kill an idea. Shel Silverstein, his body is gone, but his spirit and his ideas will live absolutely forever. This book is about giving. It's about giving. Bernie Simpkins is a giver. You know, he supports this program, supports the community. He's been very, very successful. He's had many, many businesses. But he realizes that it's not all for him. He can't keep it. You know, when you were born, you came here with nothing. You had no designer jeans on, you know, no designer jewelry. You were born buck naked. And you know, that time in between birth and the time that you leave here is really clear. It's what you do in that time. In my book, Watermelon Magic, the last chapter is about having fun. And the end of the lesson, the end of the last chapter in the book is called Having Fun. There's a little quote in the beginning from Psalms 100. It says, make a joyful noise. The Bible encourages you to have fun. It doesn't say be depressed, be angry, or sad. It says, make a joyful noise, be happy. At the end of every chapter, I created what I call a Wally Melon lesson. And the Wally Melon lesson, I took Wally from Amos and Melon from Water and put Wally Melon. The Wally Melon lesson at the end of Having Fun says, obituaries always list the year you were born and the year you died separated by a dash, 1900-1996. When you were born, when you died is not nearly as important as what you did in between, what you put in your dash. What have you put in your dash? The older I get, the more fun I want to put in my dash. If it's not fun, I won't do it. You got to enjoy what you're doing. And part of what makes life fun is giving of yourself to others, realizing that giving is receiving. This is the best book I've ever read on that subject. It's called The Giving Tree by Shel Silverstein. Once there was a tree, and she loved a little boy. And every day the boy would come, and he would gather her leaves and make them into crowns and play king of the forest. He would climb up her trunk and swing from her branches and eat. And they would play hide and go seek. And when he was tired, he would sleep in her shade. And the boy loved the tree very much. And the tree was happy. But time went by, and the boy grew older. And the tree was often alone. Then one day the boy came to the tree, and the tree said, come, boy, come and climb up my trunk and swing from my branches and eat apples and play in my shade and be happy. I'm too big to climb and play, said the boy. I want to buy things and have fun. I want some money. Can you give me some money? I'm sorry, said the tree, but I have no money. Take my apples, boy, and sell them in the city. Then you will have money, and you will be happy. And so the boy climbed up the tree and gathered her apples and carried them away, and the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long time, and the tree was sad. And then one day the boy came back, and the tree shook with joy. And she said, come, boy, climb up my tree, and swing from my branches, and be happy. I'm too busy to climb trees, said the boy. I want a house to keep me warm, he said. I want a wife, and I want children, so I need a house. Can you give me a house? I have no house, said the tree. the forest is my house, but you may cut off my branches and build a house. Then you will be happy. And so the boy cut off her branches and carried them away to build his house. And the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long time. And when he came back, the tree was so happy she could hardly speak. Come, boy, she whispered. Come and play. I'm too old and sad to play, said the boy. I want a boat that will take me far away from here. Can you give me a boat? Cut down my trunk and make a boat, said the tree. Then you can sail away and be happy. And so the boy cut down the tree and made a boat and sailed away. And the tree was happy, but not really. And after a long time, the boy came back again. I'm sorry, boy, said the tree, but I have nothing left to give you. My apples are gone. My teeth are too weak for apples, said the boy. My branches are gone, said the tree. You cannot swing on them. I'm too old to swing on branches, said the boy. My trunk is gone, said the tree. You cannot climb. I'm too tired to climb, said the boy. I'm sorry, sighed the tree. I wish I could give you something, but I have nothing left. I'm just an old stump. I am sorry. I don't need very much now, said the boy. Just a quiet place to sit and rest. I am very tired. Well, said the tree, straightening herself up as much as she could. Well, an old stump is good for sitting. Come, boy, sit down. Sit down and rest. And the boy did, and the tree was happy. The end of the story. Story so many times, and I don't know, a month or so ago, I read it, and it occurred to me that maybe the goal in life is to be the stump, is to give to that degree without expecting anything in return, but just to give, because giving is the way. Giving is the way. Giving and receiving. You know, the thing that has helped me so much in whatever success I've had is, I believe, the giving that I've done. I've been promoting literacy for 26 years. I've been involved in more organizations, and not just during good times. I mean, during times when I was struggling for money and trying to keep Famous Amos alive, I was still out promoting literacy, and I was still giving whatever I had. You always got something to give. And the thing you must always remember is that it's not yours to begin with. What you have comes from God. It comes through you. It doesn't come from you. You don't really create anything. You don't create yourself. So how can you possibly create anything else? But God who created you creates everything and said you could have it and you could have it in abundance. So believing that, having faith that that is the truth, allows you to give freely, to share whatever you give with others. And in sharing, you will find that whatever you have is multiplied thousands of times over. So if you really want to be a success, put that idea to the test and see if giving really works. I am confirmation that that absolutely works. And when you can understand that, you know, that's what it's about. You know, being famous is not a big deal. I saw a quote once that said, celebrity is the art of being known by those that do not know you. People know the image, but very rarely do you really get to know someone who is famous. You get to be with them every day and see what they're like during good times, during bad times. So for me, being famous, it's just a vehicle. It's just an opportunity for me to use everything I have to serve others. Sam Hines, who's a minister friend, said the only reason we exist is to serve one another. And I used to want, you know, I used to want to make a lot of money. I used to want to ride in limousines. I've ridden a limousine, so what? It's just a long, funny-looking car. It doesn't get you there any faster or any safer than any other vehicle. I used to want to stay at a suite at a hotel. Now I've stayed in suites at some of the best hotels in the world. So what? That doesn't make me special. It's what you feel about yourself that makes you special. It's what you give to others that makes you special. So understand, you know, it's all of that that goes into being an entrepreneur, that goes into being a human being, that goes into living, because it's about living life. It's not about existing and just floating through life. It's about living life to the fullest. And in order to live it to the fullest, then you've got to get involved in the lives of other people. You've got to support, and you've got to help, and you've got to serve others also. I'm going to share two more books. This is one of the most powerful books I've ever read. It's about love. And love is what you are. Love is who you are. Don't go in business. Don't do anything just to make money. Do what you love. Because if you don't love it, it will not last. But if you love it, it'll last. And you'll have such a great time doing it. And you know, success is not a destination. Success is a journey. So it's important to love what you're doing every day. It's important to wake up every day feeling good about where you're getting ready to go to. It's important to wake up. You gotta remember that. If you wake up, it's a great day. If you wake up, you can get all the things done that you plan to do. But if you don't, you know, that's it. So love what you do. Don't do what your parents want you to do. Don't do what your best friend is doing. Don't do what your boyfriend is doing. Don't go someplace like your girlfriend is there. You need to have a greater purpose than that. And your greater purpose is doing something that just gives you so much satisfaction that you would do it for nothing if you had to. Because sometimes you might have to. And don't pass up those opportunities, because oftentimes that's where the prize. Okay? So love is the answer. I have a friend that says, whatever the question, love is the answer. This book is called Love You Forever, written by Robert Munch, illustrated by Sheila McGraw. A mother held her new baby and very slowly rocked him back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And while she held him, she sang, I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. The baby grew, he grew and he grew and he grew, he grew until he was 2 years old, and he ran all around the house. He pulled all the books off the shelves, he pulled all the refrigerator, all the food out of the refrigerator, took his mother's watch and flushed it down the toilet. Sometimes his mother would say, this kid is driving me crazy. But at nighttime, when that two-year-old was quiet, she opened the door to his room, crawled across the floor, looked up over the side of his bed. And if he was really asleep, she picked him up and she rocked him back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And while she rocked him, she sang, I'll love you forever, like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. Well, the little boy grew, he grew and he grew and he grew and he grew until he was 9 years old. And he never wanted to come in for dinner. He never wanted to take a bath. And when grandma little restless. He said bad words. Sometimes his mother wanted to sell him to the zoo. But at nighttime, when he was asleep, the mother quietly opened the door to his room. She crawled across the floor, looked up over the side of the bed. If he was really asleep, she picked up that 9-year-old boy and she rocked him back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And while she rocked him, she sang, "I'll love you forever, like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be." Of course, the boy grew. He grew. He grew and he grew. He grew until he was a teenager. Oh, my God. Oh, yeah, strange friends. Well, strange clothes. Sometimes his pants, you can see his underwear. And he listened to strange music. Sometimes the mother felt like she was in a zoo. But at nighttime, when that teenager was asleep, the mother opened the door to his room. She crawled across the floor, looked up over the side of the bed. If he was really asleep, she picked up that great big boy and rocked him back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And while she rocked him, she sang, "I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be." Well, that teenager grew, of course. He grew and he grew and he grew. He grew until he was a grown-up man. Left home, got a house across town. But sometimes on dark nights, the mother got in her car and drove across town. If all the lights in her son's house were out, she opened his bedroom window, crawled across the floor, looked up over the side of his bed. If he was really asleep, she picked up that great big man and she rocked him back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And while she rocked him, she sang, "I'll love you forever, like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be." Well, that mother, she got older. She got older and older and older. One day she called up her son and said, you better come see me because I'm very old and sick. So her son came to see her. When he came in the door, she tried to sing the song. She sang, I'll love you forever. I'll like you for always. But she couldn't finish because she was too old and too sick. The son went to his mother. He picked her up and rocked her back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and he sang this song, "I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my mommy you'll be." When the son came home, and the son came home that night, he stood for a long time at the top of the stairs. Then he went into the room where his very new baby daughter was sleeping. He picked her up in his arms and very slowly rocked her back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And while he rocked her, he sang, "I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as love does that. So love yourself. You're the most important person in your life. And by all means, love what you do. We're going to close with a book called Calabash Cat and his amazing journey, written by a good friend of mine named James Rumford. Excuse me, 1 second. This book is a combination of kind of a lot of things I've shared and talked about. I'll summarize it after reading it. In the middle of Africa, there lived a calabash cat. One day he set off down the road to see where the world ended. When the road stops at the edge of the great desert, calabash cat sat down and thought, maybe this is where the world ends. Just then, a camel came by. He was quite surprised at how silly Calabash Cat was. Climb up on my back, and I will show you where the world ends. And they walked across the desert. But when they reached the far side of the desert, where the grasslands began, the camel stopped and said, here, my friend, is where the world ends. Calabash Cat would have believed the camel had a horse not happened by. The horse was quite surprised at how small-minded the camel had been. Climb up on my back, and I will show you where the world ends. And they galloped across the grasslands. But when they reached the far side of the grasslands where the jungle began, the horse stopped and said proudly, here, my friend, is where the world ends. Calabash Cat would have believed the horse had a tiger not shown up. The tiger was quite surprised at how full of nonsense the horse had been. Climb up on my back, and I will show you where the world ends. And they bounded through the jungle. But when they reached the ocean, the tiger stopped and said, as sure as she could be, here, my friend, this is where the world ends. Calabash Cat wouldn't believe the tiger had a whale not tall from the waves. The whale was quite surprised at how wrong the tiger had been. Climb up on my back, and I will show you where the world ends. And they swam across the sea. But when they reached the other side of the ocean, the whale said without hesitating for 1 minute, here, my friend, is where the world ends. Now when Calabash Cat looked at the miles of land in front of him, he thought how small the whale's world had been. Even the tigers and the horses and the camels, he wondered if he would ever see the end of the world. Just then, an eagle swoops down. The eagle was quite surprised at how foolish everyone had been. Climb up on my back, and I will show you a world without end. Up they went into the great sky, and Calabash Cat's eyes grew wide with wonder as he flew around the world, over oceans, jungles, grasslands, and deserts, back to his home. There's an eagle in all of us. It says life is more. It says life is never really what it seems to be. It's always more. People will come along in your life as they must to help and to support you on your way. But you cannot allow their belief system to become your belief system. You gain knowledge from them, you learn from them, and that makes you stronger. But in becoming stronger, you must become your own person. You must decide for yourself what the truth is, what it is that you want to do, what it is that pleases you, what do you do better than anything else? There's the eagle inside of all of us that pushes us on to greatness. It says you can always do more, you can always be better today than you were yesterday. So strive to be more. Be your best. Be your best. You're all marked for greatness. You really are. You can do and believe anything you want. You know, I'm a little guy who was born in 1936 in Tallahassee, Florida. And Florida was a lot different than it is now. And segregation was absolutely the rule. Grew up in a little area called Smoky Hollow. Never had a dream. Never had a career goal. Mother was a domestic worker. Father was a common laborer in a gas plant. And yet, I started several companies. And I mean, I've been up, I've been down. I've gone through a lot of stuff. Still going through stuff today. You know, life's a journey. It's not a destination. It ain't over till you take that last breath. So I am just an example. There are many examples. Bernie is just an example. Everybody's example says success is possible if you do certain things. And I've talked about some of those things that helps you to build character, that helps you to be a better person, because that's ultimately, I think, what your goal needs to be. So God bless y'all. Thank you for being here. Appreciate it very much. Have a great life. I appreciate you. Aloha.